You ready, Car Jane?
Feel your heart, see the world through your eyes. Wanna be your hands and feet, wanna live a life that leads. Ready yourselves, ready yourselves. Let us shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night. Oh, ready yourselves, ready yourselves. May the powers of darkness tremble as our praises rise. Until the whole world hears what we are calling out. Lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness, we're crying out. As the day draws near, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Lord, let your sleeping giant rise, catch the demons by surprise. Holy nation sanctified, let this be our battle cry. Ready yourselves, let us shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night. Oh, ready yourselves, may the powers of darkness tremble as our praises rise. Until the whole world hears what we are calling out. Lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness, we're crying out. As the day draws near, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa, whoa, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa, whoa, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Wanna be your hands and feet. Wanna be your life that leads. See you set the captive free. Till the whole world hears. And I pray that they will see more of you and less of me. Lord, I want my life to be the song you sing. Until the whole world hears what we are calling out. Lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness, we're crying out. As the day draws near, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa, whoa, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa. There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. And all my dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the water holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding what power set me free? There is a grave that holds nobody. Now that power lives in me. There is another in the fire. Whoa. 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 I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. He who was and still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how you've been to me, I'll count the joy from every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing's in between us. Nothing's in between us. another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the water holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be.
Amen.
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 Song, get in that. Let's start with prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for being here already in this building. You've been here preparing this environment. Every person here today that's involved with ministering, whether they're in the band or they're greeters or nursery care workers or whatever, you have been working in their hearts, helping us get up in the morning to be refreshed and to be prepared for ministering work today. We thank you for the privilege that we have to worship and love you. We ask that you open our hearts and bless our minds and fill our spirits with your great love and goodness, Lord. May we today move the ball forward a little bit. May we advance it towards the goalpost using Super Bowl imagery today, the goalpost of your kingdom being built and the return of your son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for those unable to be here today that you would touch them in their bodies, in their hearts and spirits. We pray for other churches in our community. We're part of a number of evangelical churches and we believe in the same Lord, we believe in the same scriptures, and we have the same mission together to reach this community for Christ. So I pray for the pastors and elders and leaders who serve in this community that you bless them and equip them and protect them and watch over their congregations and churches as well. So Lord, touch us today. Help us to expand our thinking today as we watch a video together, and we pray all this in your name. Amen. Before we click the video switch, Matthew, there's a picture of a map up there. I went to this island, and the year time I was born, whenever that was, 91? There you go. A long time ago. The only thing I remember is like the first time I ever left home. First time I left the continental United States, I went to Indonesia. And I was so homesick, I couldn't tell you. It was 4 weeks away. Couldn't wait to get back home. And I was on this island. Now, what animal does this island look like? Very good. It's actually, anyone want to take a shot at it? An animal that's going to be more that part of the world. Elephant. I thought it would pop right out. Everybody thinks this country lives like an elephant. This is Guinea. There you go. And I was kind of looking that way. You know, everybody do this. Put your arm right here. Now you learned a trick here. So this is where I went. And it's a province, an island in Indonesia, one of the largest countries in the world with some 200 or 300 languages, and really a powerful place, beginning with a guy named R.A. Jaffray that started the work of the Christian Missionary Alliance in this area of the world. We have a lot of missionaries, a lot of churches there. Now there's a part of this interior, now to the left of it, is the western part, obviously, and it used to be called Irian Jaya. It was called that when I went there. Now I think it's just called West Guinea, but there's a valley in there called the Baleen Valley, and it had a nickname. It's called Cannibal Valley. And when I went to visit there, they reminded us that it was only about 50 years out of the Stone Age and out of the cannibal period. It was just amazing. We went to a little village called Wamana. I don't know if it's on there, but it's in the left area. Way up at the top, Jayapura. We spent about 2 weeks in Jayapura. We ran these kids' camps, camps involved with young people that were part of the culture there that wanted to learn English. And so they came to learn English, and we played something. It was an old Focus on the Family video series. What was that thing called? 30, 40 years ago, it was a series for kids. Thanks a lot. I don't know. But I remember videotapes, I remember playing these things on the big screen. I also remember one time the government came in. They have total right to interrupt any meeting they wanted, and they wanted to teach the young people. And this kind of ties into what we're doing later today. They wanted to teach the young people. Young people would be age probably 14 to 22, about sexuality and the dangers and things like that. So they came in, did their talk, and then we did our talk. Oh, was there a Mr. McGee or something like that? McGee and me, there we go. We knew it would come. We're betraying our age. Anyway, so I had a great time there. But we found some old tape, the Alliance, some really old video about our work there. It is still a major work within the Christian Mission Alliance. Some of you might remember because she visited here several times, Ann Grinnell from Everett. She served there, but it was just a great trip. So we're going to spend a few minutes watching this little historical montage of our work. This is old stuff, but it's also a place where we continue to work. So to remind you that, about once a month, we want to remind you to make a gift to the Great Commission Fund. So when Richard receives the offering, if you could do that today, that goes into our work for places like this, okay? Lights down, cameras on, videos up and running, and enjoy.
About 80 years ago, there was a place so isolated from the outside world, the people who lived there had never seen a wheel, looked in a mirror, or held a metal object. Then, explorers discovered this secluded location, nestled in the remote central highlands of Papua, or Western New Guinea. It was home to a Stone Age tribe that practiced cannibalism and had worshipped spirits for centuries. After World War II ended, CNMA pioneers began plans to bring the gospel to these people whom time had forgotten. This is that story. And it's all been captured on never-before-seen 16mm film. In 1938, famed explorer Richard Archbold was the first Westerner to discover the Balim Valley, what missionaries would one day call Shangri-La, home to 60,000 Dani people. Archbold published his report in a 1941 issue of National Geographic. The Dani had never had contact with the outside world. Yet with no exposure to 20th century implements, their ingenuity in crafting and wielding tools of stone, wood, and bone to create extensive gardens seen from the air was astonishing. When World War II ended, Alliance pioneers felt they could now begin writing an unfinished chapter in world missions by taking the good news to the remote Dani, who had never had the opportunity to hear of Jesus' love for them. However, reaching the Dani by land wasn't an option. Because their valley home was nearly impenetrable, surrounded by snow-capped mountain peaks and edged with thick jungles and swamps, Alliance missionaries determined the only way to reach them was by air. So began plans to buy a small amphibious plane that could land on the Balim River that runs along the valley floor. A plane was purchased in 1950, but suffered damages the following year. Finally, in November 1953, a short Sealand amphibious aircraft was purchased in Belfast, Northern Ireland, where it was dedicated and named the Gospel Messenger. After years of planning and many steps of preparation, the historic day for entering the Balim Valley arrived on April 20th, 1954. Al Lewis and Ed Ulrich piloted the plane, carrying five passengers, including missionaries Einar Michelson and Lloyd Van Stone. Also aboard was a newly converted May couple, Elisa, Ruth, and their baby, Dorcas, whose tribe lived west of the Balim River. Their presence was hoped to communicate to the Dani that this wasn't a war party. Lloyd and his wife, Doris, along with their team members, had taken up the torch Joffrey laid down with his death during the war, a passion to reach the Dani with the gospel. Doris describes the anticipation of that first trip.
Lowell Thomas said it was one of the most thrilling stories of modern missions in the 20th century. Not one single person had ever heard the name of Jesus.
Before taking off, Einar said, "I don't know how we'll be received, but there's no turning back now." Lloyd grinned and quoted an armed forces motto, "We have to go in. We don't have to come back." The crew safely landed the plane on the river that day before setting up camp.
They set up a little tiny green tent, and there were two men against all of the valley out to tell men and women who Jesus was.
On the second day, as the party was paddling their rubber boat across the river to higher ground, 7 Donnie men approached them, led by the chief, shouting loudly.
And they got over there and they grabbed a hold of their arms and went, like this, and pushed them too.
Einar recognized this as the ceremony of welcome among other New Guinean tribes. He approached the chief, along with several others in the party, repeating the greeting before extending his hand. At that point, the Donnie leader threw his arms around the missionary and broke into tears. The rest of the men lowered their spears. Tribal leaders then invited the newcomers to attend a special welcome feast of roasted pig and sweet potatoes. After their first encounters with the Donnie, one of the Alliance pioneers later wrote, "So, realizing the slow, hard work ahead in months, and even years to come, these missionary heroes of the cross know that only the first chapter of their story has been written."
Welcome Pastor Richard for our announcements today. Baby. Good morning, FAC. God is good. And all the time. Was it Theodore Roosevelt said, people don't, how does it go? Oh, this was so good in my head. I want to get the quote right. I'm going to pull it up. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Golly, there it is. Have you guys had those mornings before? Oh, my goodness. So one thing I love about the Alliance is just that, what John shared, right? We go in to these places, and our mission is the gospel. We want to share the gospel, but what we really want to do is show them that we care, so then we can show them what they know. One thing that's beautiful about the Alliance is we no longer try to send missionaries over and let them start working right away. We force them, it's actually required by Alliance, to do what's called ethnographic studies. So our missionaries have to go and live in the culture before they even share the gospel or start any ministry. So it's all about enveloping into the culture and seeing how the gospel speaks into that culture. That way we're not destroying beautiful ethnicity and cultures with our Western thinking. Something I wanted to share is the beauty of our God and how His beauty is far beyond ours. I got to have a great conversation with Doug this morning, and we were just talking about how beautiful our Lord is. And in Revelations 21, it describes what's called the New Jerusalem. So the New Jerusalem, God's going to create it. It's going to come down. And it's really interesting because in Revelations 21, verse 19 and 20, it's explained that there's 12 stones that were used to create the New Jerusalem. Agate, jasper, emerald, onyx, chrysolite, beryl, topaz, janeth. There's all sorts of different emeralds and different jewels and stones. And what's really cool is if you look at them normally, they're kind of the ugly ones, which is, I just love our God so much, right? Because they're all the ugly ones. There's no diamond in there. I would, you know, if I was going to build a New Jerusalem, I'd lay that thing with diamonds. But science has recently discovered something. I'm going to put my little Russ hat on. Okay, science has recently discovered something. We can now create what's called pure light. And pure light is when we focus all the light rays into one straight line, and it's in its most pure form, pure light. What happens when we shine pure light into a diamond isn't that it sparkles like it does in this normal light. Actually, the diamond turns black. It actually shows no reflective beauty at all. When we take pure light and we shine it into a ruby, it does the same thing. The red goes away in its entirety. But when we take pure light and we shine it into all 12, every one of those that was described for the New Jerusalem, what happens to those stones is they turn rainbow. They actually emit the most beautiful colors you could imagine. Now, this is something that they would not have known back in the day. This is only a recent discovery. The 12 stones that God will use to build the New Jerusalem, when under His pure light, God is light, will shine in such a radiant rainbow color that it'll be just beautiful to us. We don't understand beauty. Amen, church? But God does, and I am so excited to join you guys and enjoy God's beauty in heaven. Amen? For announcements, we got some fun stuff. Next Saturday is our annual Sweetheart Dinner Fiesta theme. Please, if you have not purchased a ticket yet, come talk to me after church. If you can't purchase it because you don't have cash or a check with you, that's fine. Just let me know. I'm going to purchase at the door so I can get my numbers a little bit more accurate, so I'm not wasting money by buying too much or not enough food. I also have a bunch of these flyers. Some of the students were running around passing them out. Yes, John? Perfect. Yeah, you can check out tickets from me too and sell them to your coworkers or whatever you want to do. If you can't afford the Sweetheart Dinner but you can go, yes, we have benevolence. Thank you. Yeah, we don't want price to be the reason you can't come. So talk to John, talk to one of the elders. Also, I have these little invitations. I have lots of them. The youth students have started handing them out. If you'd like to take one of these so you can remind your friends to come, they're there. Also, we've been collecting raffle items. If you work for a company that typically likes to give things to nonprofits, reach out to me. I've got a bunch of letters that I can hand out, basically just asking for merchandise, gift cards. John killed it last week. He went and got us a bunch as well. And the students have been running around knocking on businesses' doors, getting raffle items. But if you happen to work for a company that would like to donate, please talk to me so we can raffle that off. Youth group is not today because of the Super Bowl. I took a vote on the students. They said they're all going to Super Bowl parties. They won't be at youth group. So no youth group tonight. However, there will be youth group the following Sunday where we will celebrate our success from the Sweetheart Dinner. Men's and women's group, 6:30 here at the church. Make sure you're getting yourself plugged in. And lastly, as you guys know, there's been a church-wide survey that's gone out. If you haven't taken that yet, we just urge you to get that done quickly because that survey is closing soon. And we really just want as much data and information as we can. And there's a lot of spots for you guys to put comments in there just about how we can be a more effective church for God's kingdom. So we'll have the offertorians come forward. Remember, as John reminded you, we are part of the Great Commission. We have a Great Commission fund. So if you have extra offerings that you can give to that, we would appreciate that because we care about missions, hence why we are the Christian and Missionary Alliance. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this church. Lord, I thank you for the work that you're doing around the world. God, we want to see people come to Christ, and that's why we send people around the world. We know and there will be a day where it's shut off, where there will be no more people born because the end has come, Lord. And we want to make sure that before we get to that moment, we get as many souls saved as possible. So help use this money for the Great Commission. Allow it to go out and really make a big impact. Don't let it be wasted away on formalities and all sorts of institutional stuff, Lord. We want to make sure that all of our money goes directly to the source of seeing people saved. Lord, we belong to a great denomination, and we trust it, Lord. And we just ask again that you will multiply this money and send it out to the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. Christ, my Lord, now I'm raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart.
Bring new wine out.
make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Church, before we listen to scripture read, the second verse of this new song. This is our first time with it, second time maybe, pretty new. You guys did great. It says, make me your vessel. And we're going to talk today about how all of us, our whole body, soul, and spirit belong to the Lord. Make me your vessel. Make me an offering to you. Make me whatever you want me to be. Father in heaven, be with us now as we hear your word read. Lord, I have the faith to believe that irrespective of a sermon message, just the reading of scripture is powerful. And there's something that you want folks to hear just from the reading that Patty's going to do from 1 Corinthians 6. Speak to us, Lord. It is frankly a delicate subject, not one that I would pick off the shelf on a given Sunday, but still a big, big part of this book of 1 Corinthians. So I want to pray, Lord, that our ears would be open and our hearts receptive to what you would have for us today. Make us your vessel, Lord. We give our body, our whole selves to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Amen. The reading this morning is 1 Corinthians. And 1 Corinthians 9.
Six.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had that switched. 6:9-20. There we go. Do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And that is what some of you were. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach, and the stomach for food. But God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with her is with her in one body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh. For he who unites himself with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from this sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside of his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body.
Well, I know if Deidre was here, she'd say, amen, right? She's down in California, but oh my goodness. I have to be honest with you. I've been pondering this message for weeks, running it through my brain. Whether I got it or not, I'm not sure, but I've put a lot of work into this one. I feel good enough about it that I hope that you will share it, even with friends, especially teenagers. I have thought in my own mind of younger people listening to it. It is age appropriate, and it begins with a comment about the title. Broken body, broken body. This occurred to me as I was studying these first six chapters. In the first four chapters, Paul is dealing with the broken body of Christ. This is a church in conflict because they got some really weird ideas about leadership. We won't hash through that again, but they're going, you know, groups were creating factions. I like Peter, I like Paul, I like Apollos, and it was just causing a conflict in the church. Then if you go further in the letter, there's a conflict about communion. Then in chapters 12 through 14, there's conflicts about spiritual giftedness. This is a broken body. And somehow Paul manages to pivot. And I know exactly the point is, the point in the message where he sort of pivots from church issues to dealing with sexuality, which I would say is also dealing with broken body, right? Broken human body. And how many of you at least know somebody, if not yourself, that has experienced brokenness because you've messed up or somebody's messed up sexually? There you go. It's so people are broken for a lot of reasons, but sex is a big reason why, and it's an important topic. And I hope that we're discussing it with people in our lives, our especially our children. I've told this story before, and quite frankly, it's the only story I know that has to do with sex that I can actually share in church. It goes like this. This is something that Diane shared with me. Diane, as you know, is one of how many kids? She's one of seven. You say, now you know where we got it, okay? She was one of seven wonderful kids with great parents. And one time, Diane came home from school, and she heard a naughty word. And she didn't know what the naughty word was. It's the kind of word that you would not share in church. And so she asked her mom, what does this word mean? And her mom, who's a great teacher, compassionate, looked down at Diane. And Diane, do you remember how old you were? About?
Eight.
You say, you sing Yankee Doodle with an F as the first consonant of a word. We won't try that in church, okay? Because I think I have an idea where this thing heads. But you get the point. So, Mom, what does this word mean? Which is, by the way, that's so beautiful that a kid would be comfortable to go home to a parent and ask that question, 8 years old. And my mother-in-law, who passed away last year, she said, you know, sweetheart, Dookie, that was her name growing up, that's a bad word for a special gift that God has given married people. And so she then explained what we would call the birds and the bees to Diane as an eighth-year-old, and you can imagine, mortified to hear the graphic details of what that word meant in a positive context. And the mom explained, this is for a husband and a wife. And after she was done telling the story, my mother-in-law said, well, do you have any questions? And Diane goes, you and Dad did that seven times? So it's always room for explanation and improvement, and I hope we can cover that today. This is really a relevant passage for us. This city of Corinth, this is a train wreck of a city. If you could take Los Angeles, New York City, San Francisco, Las Vegas, New Orleans, and cram them into one city, that's what Corinth was about. It was a place of huge immorality. It had a temple. Did we have a picture of that temple we can flash up there? The temple for Aphrodite. Well, you can look it up yourself. It's this temple. It was a religious place for Aphrodite, who was a goddess of fertility and goddess of love. And some scholars suggest there were about 1,000 paid prostitutes called priestesses that attended this place. It was just a mess. And the way it worked was, this is like sort of a port city. You may have remembered from the map we showed earlier that Corinth is in part of Greece. It's with like an isthmus, very thin piece of land. And there wasn't a canal at the time, but eventually there was a canal built to get across. And it was just a very popular place for ships to unload their stuff. Wagons would take it across the isthmus, like I think about 3 miles, and then we'd load on other ships. It was a sailor town, in other words. And so there was a lot of stuff that people could buy there. There was a lot of men, I'll come back to men in just a second, just a lot of immorality in this place. It's kind of a place where anything goes. You could buy anything you want, including both male and female prostitutes. Now, it was such a bad place that if you called a person a Corinthian, it was code for, here's a pretty racy person, okay? That's what we're talking about here. And so this is it's relevant to us because I would say, quite frankly, that Corinth is probably more immoral than what we have today because they weren't particularly respectful of children, young boys, and of women as well. So without going into details, you probably understand what that means. So I would like to set things up with 4 introductory remarks that I think are absolutely necessary before we move through the book, okay? Remark number 1 is our business as a church is the holiness and devotion of believers and the church, not the perfection of a fallen world. And so if you're listening to this message online, this is not a message that I'm sharing with the world. It's really for God's people, for the church. I think there's a difference. I think Paul tells us there's a difference in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 12, a passage that Pastor Richard covered for us. When Paul says to the church, it's dealing with a kind of a legal issue, what business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? It's a rhetorical question. Let me read it again. What kind of business is of mine, 1 Corinthians 5, 12, to judge those outside the church? It's not. Our domain of judgment is the church, those that profess to be Christians. He goes on and says, are you not to judge those inside? God will judge those outside. And then he says, expel the wicked person from among you. He's quoting an Old Testament verse. The church should be a place of holiness. We shouldn't expect the world to be a place of holiness. And this is consistent with Jesus' words about judgment in Matthew chapter 7. He says, you know, judge not lest you be judged. He says, first take out the speck out of your own, the plank out of your own eye before you judge somebody else. I think that's also a message for the church, that we should not be focused on the world until we get our own house in order. Does that make sense? Is that a fair thing to say? Because we can get wrapped up in the world. And I guess I want to give you a little hint here. We're losing as far as the culture wars in the world are concerned. Would you, anybody disagree with me? We are just losing in this area of sexuality in terms of Christian metrics. But we're not losing if we focus on these issues within the church. So again, first main point, this is a message for the church. This is not a message for unbelievers. Number 2, regarding Christian sexual ethics. I tried to come up with a statement that I thought was a biblical statement about sexuality that we could hang our hat on. I came up with this. For God's people, those in his church, sex is God's gift for creating family and building permanent intimacy in marriage between a husband and a wife, and is consensual, tender, generous, and exclusive within the covenant of that marriage, okay? I think that's a fair definition of what the entirety of biblical thought is on sexuality and intimacy. I'd like to read that again. Regarding Christian ethics, Christian sexual ethics, for God's people, those in his church, sex is God's gift for creating family and building permanent intimacy in marriage between a husband and a wife, and is consensual, tender, generous, and exclusive within the covenant of that marriage. And if you're not in that relationship, if you're not married, then the scriptures tell us that we are to live richly, richly as both Jesus and Paul did, but celibate. Scripture portrays celibacy in a very, very positive life. And we have some fabulous examples of that. Last week, I also mentioned an author that I like in these very delicate areas, and he covers it delicately but biblically. And this, and I'll just give it again. His name is Preston Sprinkle, recently written, just, I thought, very thoughtful books on the on same-sex attraction and also on the transgender issue. Now, I'm asked, does Jesus say much about marriage and sex and same-sex attraction? Well, Jesus never said anything that I can find about same-sex attraction, but he did have something to say about marriage, and I'd like to read it from Mark chapter 10. This is a fabulous passage I think we should have as a basis of our foundation as to how we look at the issue of marriage and sexuality. Mark 10, verse 2. There are some Pharisees that came to Jesus to test him. I don't know how many times we read this phrase. They came to test him. Well, they came to test him by asking, verse 2 of Mark 10, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? There's a great conversation starter. Is it okay to get divorced? Well, what did Moses command you? Jesus replied. They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away, which is true. In the Old Testament, there was a way out of marriage. But Jesus responds like this. It was because your hearts were hard that Moses wrote you this law. In other words, yes, he did. But it's not what God's original intention was. It was the following. Jesus replied, and he quotes from Genesis 2, but at the beginning of creation, God made them male and, go ahead and say it, female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. And the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. And let's face it, if there's anybody in the whole Bible that likes to break new ground, it is Jesus, right? He doesn't seem to break new ground here, if you know what I mean. He doesn't seem to suggest in any possible way anything outside the creation order, necessity of a man and a woman, a husband and wife, to make what in Jesus' mind is called marriage. And he emphasizes here that the one fleshness, and clearly this is Jesus's touching on the issue of sexuality. They come together in such a way that they become one flesh. It's something very special. And Paul grabs that statement and fleshes it out a little bit more in our passage. But Jesus never ever, from we can tell, talks about same-sex attraction, just about sexuality and marriage. The point of all this, again, is the values of the world around us in the church are not the same. And I'm speaking to the church. I'm not speaking to the community. Somebody might plug in later on and listen online. This is a message for the church. And the nice thing about our country, in our country we have a little item called the First Amendment, which gives us the right to assemble. We choose to assemble with some core beliefs and values and practices. You don't have to join us, but we believe in the biblical model of marriage and sexuality. Remark number three. Knowing this, that we make mistakes, that we've gone on different journeys that have had some painful episodes. There's shame and there's guilt. And if I asked everybody here, if you could undo something from your past and it had to do something with sex, put up your hands, we'd probably have most of the room with hands up here. And the point is that Paul wants us to not dwell on that. He doesn't want us to embrace that as the centrality of our identity. He says that our identity and self-worth today are not defined by any wrongdoing or sin that we've done in the past if we are a genuine believer. And we said last week that my past does not define me. I'm defined by my present and future standing in Christ. Now, Matthew's got that on the board up there. Could we read that quotation that's in the second half together? Let's read it together. My past does not define me. I'm defined by my present and future standing in Christ. And more than anything in this message or any message like that, I want you to receive Christ's forgiveness. If you've done something or been involved with something or been hurt by somebody else in this area, you have a Lord and Savior that's on your side. Paul says, verse 9 of chapter 6. We've heard it from Patty, but I want to read it again. Don't you know? The language here is that you should know this. This is elementary Christianity. Don't you know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? So don't be deceived. And he comes up with this list here. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, I'm in verse 9, nor adulterers. And this next phrase, I should explain it. It's a very, very, very difficult phrase. The NIV has kind of done something here. They call it, nor men who have sex with men. Let me just say, those are two words there. The first word, it probably refers to the more, the younger, more submissive, passive person in this same-sex relationship. And then the second word here is the more dominant, controlling person. That would be probably a very accurate rendition of the language. This is not an equal relationship here. And we know from both the Greeks and the Romans, when they went off to battle, they took younger people with them to take care of their troops, if you know what I mean. I know that's horrible to say, but it's true. And that's probably what's going on here. It may not be voluntary, in other words, for certain parties here. So those people will not enter the kingdom, nor are thieves, nor greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, gossipers, if that is, those who spread information, whether true or false, in order to bring division, as opposed to unity, nor swindlers, and that may be referring to what was in the earlier chapter about the guy, the lawsuit between two people. There may have been some disagreements about business. They will not inherit the kingdom of heaven, but the key punchline is verse 11. And that is what some of you were. If there were a more important word than were, I'm not sure what it would be. And that is what some of you were. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit. We looked at this last week. You have been purchased out of that yuck and that garbage and that slime of immorality, and you're now a new person. So we have in these three verses a wonderful balance of justice and mercy. The justice part is God's going to keep heaven righteous. And so people who persist in this behavior aren't getting in. And does that mean a Christian, is that a Christian who's continuing? Paul would probably say, if you're still doing this stuff, you're probably not a Christian, but you're not getting in is his point. But the other side is mercy, justice and mercy. Justice, those that are persisting in this aren't getting in. Mercy, that's what some of you were. But you were changed by Christ. My fourth preliminary remark, and then we get into the text. And this is really important. I remember exactly when this hit me. I was in Regina, Saskatchewan, visiting where I used to go to school and sat in on our New Testament class. I think it was on Corinthians. And it hit me. When you look at the New Testament, the four Gospels, is it not true that Jesus loves, supports, protects, redeems, and makes whole sexually broken people? Isn't that true? I used to put the word women there. I used to say this, Jesus loves, supports sexually broken women, which is true, but I realized that this should include everybody. But the reason I chose women is because so many stories in the Bible are stories of Jesus' tender heart with women. And never, ever a hint of scandal. Everything about that? The whole New Testament, 3 years of his life, ministering to people, never anybody saying, oh, I wonder about Jesus and Mary. I wonder about Jesus and, these women. The worst that was said of Jesus, and Jesus seemed to embrace it as a title. Look at Jesus. He's a friend of sinners. And Jesus would say, amen. Jesus, friend of sinners. So the two stories that you know so well is Jesus at the well, woman at the well, and I love that story, and we'll come back to it some other day, but, Jesus at the well, and this woman needs water, and Jesus said, how about some living water? I'm the living water, and I can see you're a prophet, and yeah, I am a prophet, and by the way, you're with, how many husbands have you been with? And brings her the water of life. This woman who, by herself, is getting fetching water. Probably there's some children involved. She goes when nobody else is there, than in the heat of day, because she doesn't want to be seen. But that's when Jesus went. Jesus went to see people who didn't want to be seen and touches her and gives her life. And the other great story doesn't just give her life, gives her physical life, is the woman who was going to be stoned in John chapter 8. John chapter 8, and they drag her out there. Hey, Jesus, well, this woman, she broke the law. Are you for the law or against the law? Trying to put Jesus in a trap. And Jesus said, I know the law. Tell you what, anybody here who's not broken the law, go ahead and throw the first stone. Jesus was friends with people in broken, again, adulteress, two adulteresses, prostitutes, harlots. Jesus was in their camp. He was a friend of sinners. And our church should be friends with sinners. Amen? We should be friends with people who've broken lives and give people chances to bring their lives back together. So again, those are four preliminary remarks. We'll quickly go through what I'm going to call 10 essential non-negotiable sex principles. Okay? Here we go. Number one. You know this already. God takes our decisions regarding sex most seriously. I know it should go without saying, but I'm not sure we get that. God takes our decisions regarding sex and intimacy most seriously. In our passage, he warned of those who would not inherit the kingdom, and those that will not inherit the kingdom, some of them involved with sexual immorality. We have this tendency to compartmentalize our lives. We have our work life, we have our family life, we have our church life, and then we have our sin life. And we sort of think the other two kind of cover that up. Did you know God sees everything? You get that? God sees everything. Number two, principle number two. A change in ethics and values is the hallmark and demonstration of faith. Okay? A change in our ethics, positive change, and values is a hallmark and demonstration, and I would say proof of our faith. That's why he could say in verse 11, and that is what some of you were. This list of crummy stuff, some of you were these people, but you were washed and sanctified. And I would suggest, in all sincerity, if you've come to Christ and there's been no change in your value system and no change in your behavior, you didn't get Christ, you got something else. You got a phony brand of Christianity. And don't ever hesitate to say, you know, I'm not sure I really got it. I'm not sure I really got my life hasn't changed at all. In fact, maybe it's gotten worse since the day I believe. A lot of people are going to hear those words from Jesus, Matthew 7. I never knew you. I never knew you. Number three, as with many things, extremes need to be avoided. And so Paul is writing these quotations that were probably popular sayings in his day, you know. Sayings that we have today, like we like to say, live and let live, right? Live and let live, or, you know, just do it, Nike. And we have our own sayings. There is a saying that basically translated, I have the right to do anything. Okay? Paul's quoting that. Then he goes on and says, but not everything is beneficial. Let's back it up a bit. Think about it. I have a right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. And so Paul is dealing with a culture there in Corinth where they thought you could just do anything with your bodies, with your lives, with your appetites. Certainly with food, there was no prohibition on foods that you eat. They didn't understand the diets that we are concerned about today. But here's a group of people that, in terms, and Paul is very clearly drawing an analogy. Those that are thinking that you can eat any food you want are the same ones that say you can engage in sexual behavior, any appetite that you have, any way that you want. But here's what's odd about this whole thing. If you go a few verses later to the next chapter, verse 1, you read this. And this is important about extremes. Now, for matters that you wrote me about, so we're reminded here that Paul wrote a previous letter. They've now written a letter to him. And in this letter, they write these words. It is good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman. This could also be a question. Is it good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman? See what's going on here? You've got some of the church who anything goes, and others are saying, well, we sort of believe that men and women shouldn't have sex at all. Jesus confronted the same issue one time when he was explaining marriage and divorce and fidelity to disciples. You remember them saying to him one time? Jesus, maybe it's better for us not to marry. And then Jesus went on and talked about celibacy. The point is, there were two extremes happening. A lot of times when you deal with church matters, you've got polarizing both sides. One side says, anything goes. Other side says, nope, nothing goes. And we want to avoid extremes, and I'm hoping that we've done that today. Number four, regarding gray areas of life, and there are a bunch of them today, you know, gray areas of life. Let's say going to movies. I would say going to movies that are maybe more racy, more edgy, would be a gray area. I'm not going to make rules about that. But in gray areas, there are two overriding questions that Paul poses. Is it beneficial or is it enslaving? Is it beneficial or is it enslaving? Is it beneficial to my family? Is it beneficial to my church? Just because it's legal doesn't make it good or right. And there are a whole gamut of issues. Drinking. Today, marijuana use. I've yet to see it break out as an issue in the church, but it will. It will sometime, because it's legal. Things that are legal may not necessarily be good or right. So Paul says this. You know, I have a right to do anything. And you say this. But not everything is beneficial. Not everything benefits my family, my life, my church. Then he says, and I have the right to do anything, but I won't be mastered by anything. You say, food for the stomach and stomach for food, and God will destroy them both. And that's true. And that touches us on this Greek view of the Bible, the body. So there's these two extremes. Some Greeks believed because the body really didn't matter, it was only the soul and the spirit and the essence that mattered, that you could do whatever you wanted with your body and God didn't care. The other extreme was you had to beat the body down. You had to deny the body. You had to fast. You had to deny yourself in order to control the body. So you have these two powerful extremes, both coming out of Greek thought and Greek culture. And Paul seems to be tackling both here. Again, we don't know where these quotes came from. They seem to be local slogans. But I think they give us some good questions to ask on any issue where we're not sure. I am not sure I should be doing this. I am not sure I should be going here. I am not sure I should be reading this book. I'm not sure I should be watching this movie. Ask the question, is this beneficial or is it enslaving? We've mentioned movies. How about gambling? And I used to go down to the casino pretty regularly, because that's where our Chamber of Commerce lunch was held. Never put a dime in a machine or put anything on a table. I'm there. But it's always a little awkward when I see somebody I know there. And I'll be honest with you, I don't really care. I really don't care. Unless there's an addiction, a compulsion, and if you're spending more money on gambling than God's work, it just has a simple benchmark, an easy no-brainer benchmark, there may be a problem there. I'm afraid to ask who's going to gamble today on a game. There is a Super Bowl game today. Did you know? I looked this up. Last Super Bowl, $16 billion were waged for the football game. Today, it's $23 billion and counting. $23 billion on the line in this game. Get this, though. It's about 70 million Americans, or 1 in 4, are gambling today on the game, the results of the game. But not just that. There's some other really important stuff that's being gambled on today. Like what color jersey is going to go over the first touchdown today? Or what number will cross the goalpost line first? Or what color of Gatorade will be splashed on the winning coach? You can bet on that. You can bet on what color Taylor Swift will be wearing today, the prominent color that she'd be wearing, or whether or not Travis Kelce will propose to her today. So you can bet on just about anything, and the fact is people do bet on things like that, and it's highly addictive. So with all these things, I would encourage getting help if there is an addiction there. Again, if you're spending a lot of money and you're not taking care of your family, it's a problem. How about food? And regarding food, we probably all could think about that a little bit, especially the expense, you know, with the inflation, anything expensive food, it's extravagance. So just things to think about. Paul basically is opening the door to asking the question, is it beneficial I'm pretty sure that a gallon of ice cream is beneficial to somebody. Maybe me. It's one of my favorite things. It's beneficial, or if it's enslaving. And you know whether something's enslaving or not. And I urge you to ask for help if it is. Number five. This is the key point of this paragraph, I think, which is that sexual sins are different. I don't want to say worse or better, but they're different. Sexual sins are different, unique, and must be understood as such. Why are they different? Because sexual sins create a permanent joining of spirit and soul with somebody else. Let me read what Paul says, and then I want us to think about some examples here where it's easy to see the difference. Food for the stomach and stomach for food, and God will destroy them both. The body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. The body belongs to God, first and foremost. By his power, he raised the Lord from the dead, and he'll also raise us. That's how important the body is. The body will be raised. It's not getting left behind. Don't ask me how that works, but we will receive a glorified body. Now, so we should take care of it. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? So then, should I take the members of Christ, something that really is part of Christ, belongs to Christ, unite them with a prostitute? May it never be, or no way. Verse 16, don't you know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said the two will become one flesh. There's a principle given to us in Genesis that when two people come together, there is a new oneness that doesn't occur with other sins. For whoever is united with the Lord is one with him. And then verse 18, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body. This is something that takes place in the most intimate parts of our bodies. But whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. So think about any number of bad things we could do. If I steal a car and feel bad about it, or anything, I can return it. I can pay them back. There's a number of things you can do to remedy. If I gossip somebody, it takes a little work, but I can go back. You know, I'm going to repair your reputation. I'm going to go out and tell people that you're not that kind of a person. Racism, the sin of racism. We can turn our lives around and do some good in that area. But how do you undo sexual sin? How do we undo behavior in which we're as close as we can possibly be with someone else in a wrong way? And that's Paul's point here. Again, we are forgiven, such as some of us were, but we still have to face the facts that sexual sin is just different. It's just different. And there are consequences to it as well. I think of this Jeremiah 17:9 that says the heart is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. Sexual sin causes us to lie to ourselves, to lie to our own hearts. And there are consequences to sexual immorality. I mean, would anybody argue that the world wouldn't be a better place if it followed the model of biblical marriage and biblical sexuality? Because right now we have, used to be about 18% of newborns were born to one parent and not a two-parent home. That was in 1980. Now it's 40%. So kids needing a mom and a dad, both, that aren't always getting it because they're being birthed into homes, 40%. And we know that children that grow up without a good set of two parents, it takes two, I'll tell you, I've done it. done it with Diane, sometimes I wish I had four or five parents, but two is a good number to have. But when boys especially grow up without a dad, they're headed to poverty, they're headed to not as good of education, they're headed to gangs, and if you visit any jail, and you ask the incarcerated, tell us about your dad, you're not going to get a very positive picture. There's also diseases. I read this yesterday. According to the United States Government Office of Disease Prevention, there's some fun reading for you. Quote, although many STI sexually transmitted infections are preventable, there are more than 20 million estimated new cases in the United States each year, and the rates are increasing. 20 million. Chlamydia, gonorrhea, syphilis, herpes, AIDS. And I asked myself, we just got through this COVID plan of attack, right? Remember the 6-foot rule? Anybody still see the stickers on floors? They're still there, aren't they? The 6-foot markers. I don't know who came up with 6 feet, but I think we should apply the 6-foot rule to relationships. Boys and girls, 6 feet. You'd get more done, more benefit, if we had the 6-foot rule for young people and for old people as well. Number 6, we need to reclaim the body for God. We need to reclaim the body for God. Again, we're not Greek in our Christian view of the body. Extremes, one extreme, do whatever you want. The other extreme, you can ignore it because it's not important. The body belongs to the Lord. In fact, it's called, and this is number 7. Strength and motivation come from this beautiful, amazing, and mysterious truth that God resides in me. Verse 19, we are the temple of God. We are God's temple. Number 8. Sex is a powerful thing. It just simply is. And I think most of us understand that. But regarding overcoming sexual sin, do not stand your ground. Don't fight it. Don't do battle against it, but rather flee it. Think about that for a moment. He tells us in verse 18, flee from sexual immorality. And our model for this, of course, is Joseph in the Old Testament, who Potiphar's wife tried to seduce Joseph, and Joseph just left. He ran. Don't try to fight it. Don't try to stand up against it. Don't hold your ground. Get out of there. Whatever the situation, get out of it. And we have this sense I heard one of my colleagues use the phrase brinkmanship. We got to see how close we can get to the fire before we get burned. We can get a little closer next time. I think it goes to things like racy movies, get more racy as the days go on. How about late hours with a coworker, where the boundaries start to come down? Oh, those special close friendships. Pornography is a big problem for both men and women, and hard to beat unless you ask for help. And don't be surprised if the person you ask for help from is that, I get it. Been there, done that, I wanna help you. Number 9, simple one. The Bible teaches about sex, so we should too, okay? The Bible talks a lot about sex. I'd have to tear out a lot of pages like Thomas Jefferson did. But there's so much in there. And so I think the application here is to parents. You know, dads, you need to talk to your boys about the power of sex, that no means no, and that they can have control over this. This is something they're not consigned to the rest of their lives to being controlled by, but they can control their urges and to flee sexual immorality. Girls, I don't know. Girls need to be told that boys appear to be wired differently. I was told one time that boys have a relationship in order to have sex, and girls have sex in order to have a relationship. I don't know. Whether they're the same or different, I don't know for sure. I've had both, and they're both a handful, but boys are probably wired differently, and girls need to be explained that. Girls, you should expect them to honor your boundaries. We said that to all of our daughters. Your dates need to respect your boundaries. No means no, and don't take no from them as an answer. If they love you, they will respect you, and wanting you does not mean that they love you. And just one more thing, I have just noticed in my 35 years of doing this, that once young people are intimate, it changes them. And I'm not sure if it changes them to the better. And I think it's a wonderful thing when you get the privilege occasionally of seeing 2 young people get married, which I have, who've not been intimate yet. It's a wonderful, blessed thing. Last one. I want to give you a memory verse, okay? Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. No limits. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. And I put this verse here because it reminds us that there needs to be an alternative. You can't just be fighting and fleeing and resisting sexual morality. There needs to be something positive that you're doing instead. It's much like when Jesus said that when you cast out one demon, another one's going to come in. You need to have an alternative. He's given us the alternative here, is to serve one another humbly and in love. So would you close this message with me by reciting that verse? It's up there. Let's read this together. And let's stand together as we're reading it. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Here we go. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Father, thank you for your word. I thank you that occasionally we have to cover this subject. It's unavoidable. It's hurt so many people to misuse their gift of sexuality. Pray, Lord, that you would grant deep and real forgiveness to those who still experience the shame and guilt of things they've done and also things done to them. The victim part of this thing here. May our young people, boys and girls, learn mature values and principles regarding their bodies. And first and foremost, that their bodies belong 100% to Jesus. I pray for those young people who've struggled in this area in various capacities, Lord, that you grant them faith. They know that they can do better. They can turn things around here and now, and that they would make that decision today to do that, Lord. I thank you for parents who take the time to sit with their teenagers and younger to explain this to them with open and gracious, compassionate hearts. I also give you thanks for parents who have the capacity to be gracious and forgiving and understanding, and perhaps even remembering what it was like to be teenagers ourselves. I pray that FAC will be a place of strong and getting stronger marriages. I pray FAC will be a place where young people can come and be equipped and have the power to say yes at the right time and no at the right time. I pray be with our leaders who work with young people, that we would be ever vigilant to make sure that everybody that comes to this place comes to a safe place. Not just physical safety, which is important, but also just safety in terms of how we craft our messages here. I am conscious that someone will be troubled by this message today. I'm also conscious that you're greater than the message because you're the author of Scripture. May you speak to our hearts, and I pray this all in your name. Amen. Thank you. And we have a closing song. That the band might pop up here while he's praying. It's one of our favorite songs. We've done it about 3 times. You guys have been really awesome about new tunes. This is Testify to Love. Let's really sing it.
The sea.
accept your kingdom come. Every hope in every heart will speak what love has done. For as long as I shall live, I will testify to love. I'll be a witness in the silences when words are not enough. With every breath I take, we'll give thanks to God above. For as long as I shall live, I will testify to love.
Testify, 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 testify.
I think so. Thank you to the band and the guys in the back that were able to do this. It's pretty fun. May God bless you. May God keep you close to Him. May God lift up His face and His countenance upon you. May God give you a sense of strength and courage to fight your battles, to flee when you need to flee. May God in His grace also repair our hearts. Hearts that are broken, hearts that may have shame and regret. And remember that Jesus is on your side, whose whole life, never a hint of scandal, always standing with the broken, always standing with the injured. May God give you peace. May God give you joy. May God bring a new, refreshing relationship with yourself, with your partner, with your spouse. And may you be glorifying Him this week in His name. Amen. Thank you.